Welcome to the continuation of the stream of last week. We've had a lot of subjects already talked about. Today we're going to continue about it, and some things I will recap in comparison to last week, so everybody's still aware of all the stuff we've been talking about. One of the things that I want to say first is how to format your USB drives. I see so many people having issues with formatting their devices. The first one is pretty simple. If you have a USB device smaller or equal to 32 gigabytes, I think the best is to format as FAT32. You can have difficult format methods, but FAT32 always works, and it is easy to remember. So 32 gigabytes and smaller, use FAT32. As you can see, you can use USB devices of up to 32 gigabytes, SD cards and SDHC cards. And SDHC are the little bit larger cards, and you always format them FAT32. The issues, the challenges are there when you are using a device that's larger than 32 gigabytes. So larger than 32 gigabytes, if it's a USB device, then you can continue. If you have an SD card larger than 32 gigabytes, I know sometimes they work, but most often they also don't work. I get a call from people when they don't work, so that's where I learned. Don't use SD cards larger than 32 gigabytes, because they are called SDXC cards, and these are officially not supported on the hardware. So if you have a USB device larger than 32 gigabytes, then it's depending on your operating system how you should format them. If you have a Windows machine, you should also format larger USB devices as FAT32. If you have a Mac, you can choose. You can choose FAT32, but I would use HFS Plus or macOS Extended, as it is called. It's a much more stable file system, and it works faster. For the CDJ, it doesn't really matter which one you use, because the reading speed of a USB, it's fast enough. But when you're on a Mac and using HFS Plus and you need to export a big playlist, you will be happy that you've chosen HFS Plus. I'm going to show you how to format the device on a Mac. And the tool that you need is called the Disk Utility. The Disk Utility gives you an overview of all devices that you have. And if you do not see these... If you don't see these two entries for your USB, and you're only seeing one, the thing that you might need to do is change the view settings and make it so that you show all devices. What you're seeing down here, the first entry you see is for the device that you inserted. The second entry, that's a little bit of indented, that's called no name in this screen, that's actually the partition that is on that device. So there could be more than one partition, but don't create more than one partition when you want to use the USB device on a CDJ, as the CDJs can only access the first partition on any device. Okay, so what's the difference? And normally you would only see the volumes. When you are hitting it, you have to go to the menu in top, and that's where you can check the erase. If you are pressing erase and you have two choices, this is the wrong place to be. This should be your reminder. So then you're going to add show all devices and click the one against the left side border. Now, when you press the erase button, you will see that you have three options. The first one is the name. I don't really care at this point in time. The second one is your format system. As this is a smaller device, I can choose either MS-DOS FAT or I can choose macOS Extended. Do not choose XFAT, as this will not work. Also, don't choose a case-sensitive file system. So the valid choices are macOS Extended and MS-DOS FAT. In this case, it's a 16 gigabytes USB, so I choose MS-DOS FAT. Also, make sure that the last section is set to Master Boot Record, MBR, and not on GUID partition table, and also not on the Apple partition table, so use Master Boot Record. And then you say, okay, and now it's going to erase the partition from this device, recreate that partition as a clean new device. If you would not be doing it this way and you would select the indented one, what you actually do is not remove the partition, but you clear that partition. And what you always want to do when you format your device, you want to restart as fresh as possible. So you want to recreate that partition. And that is how you format your devices. Now we dive into a little bit more of the whole process. How do I get files from any, and I call it a download source or incoming source, how do they end up in my collection? The first thing that I always do when I have new files is that I always gonna listen to them. Because even though you download files from a proper file system or from Beatport or from any other place where you can find legit files, it's not to say that these big platforms have the perfect audio files. So I always listen very carefully to every track that I want to put into my collection. You don't want to have dropouts, you don't want to have peaks that increase, and you also want to prevent that you have bad quality files in your system. I have a few steps that I always follow when I want to have my files in my record box. And everything basically starts in the first incoming folder. So let's say I've downloaded a bunch of tracks from Beatport. First thing that I'm going to do, I'm going to drop them in any file. I don't care about which style it is or the subdivision or anything like that. I just put all the files in one folder. So I have everything together, and in my case, I normally bring that file or that folder in my car. So when I'm driving to appointments, that time will come back again at the end. Then I'm going to listen to all those tracks, and I have the time in my car to listen 3 or 4 or 5 times to the tracks. Then I have a memory of those tracks. When I'm home again, I go through this list, and then I know there's always rubbish tracks within any stack of files that you download. So then you can go quickly, listen, okay, skip, 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 delete, skip, delete, skip, delete. So this is your first major step to remove all the really bad stuff. And then what you then have left is, in that folder, there are doubtful cases, there's good files. So in the second step, then again, I have removed a lot of those files. I'll take this in my car, or when I'm doing office work at home, or when I'm whenever doing whatever and I put on a music, then I'm going to listen to it again. So then again, I have a refreshing in my mind that these are the files that I have on my stick. Later, I will go through this list again and again remove everything that's not very good. Or perhaps you have of a certain track, there's like 3 mixes that are left after the first selection. This is the time where I make my selection. What am I going to play? Some people want to have everything within their collection, but sometimes when an artist drops a track, there's like 6 remixes on that release. Should you put them all 6 in your collection? I don't, because normally I just want to have the club version and perhaps one of the remixes that I really like. I have no use for all the files, which is obviously different for everybody, because some people really want to have all their files with them. I think that a DJ should make a selection, and what I'm going to play, that's what I'm going to like, or and that's going to define your style at the end. So when I'm done through this list, I only have left in that folder all the files that I really like and that I want to put into my collection. Then I'm going to do the next step. The next step is categorizing. And as we spoke about in the last stream, I have a folder system, and this is the place where I'm going to categorize all my tracks. So I'm going to think about the musical genres that these tracks are and where they should fit in my collection. That's what I'm doing at the end of all listening, and then I know that all the tracks that I'm going to put in my collection, those are the good tracks. And then I have to figure out, okay, where do you need to fit in my collection? This is a picture you saw earlier. This is how I have made my collection. So I have one folder called Vinyl Collection, and that's your master folder with which hold all the tracks that you have in your record box. The first division are the genres, the things that I call genre. If a genre like old school has a lot of tracks, I'm going to make a subdivision if needed. It's not always needed, but then I'm going to make a subdivision. The first row I'm going to put in the genre tag of the files, and the second one I'm going to put in the album tag of the tracks. This way I have my tracks set up, and by sorting them I can just drag them in the folder. Okay, what's going to happen when you import them in Rekordbox? Rekordbox, I'm always importing my main collection folder like I showed you last time, and Rekordbox is going to include all the subfolders. It's going to check if there's any files in any of the subfolders and it will add them. Rekordbox has columns with a lot of information like the artist and the title, stuff like that, genre, album. It's reading that from the ID3 tags. What were those ID3 tags again? Again, a slide from last time. You have a file, the ID3 tags is a little bit of information at the beginning and the end of the file, and you have to put that in. You can do that on several ways. Rekordbox has a method how you're gonna add the tracks. But before I'm gonna do that, I use a different tool to get the majority of my tracks sorted out. Rekordbox is fine, but sometimes you need more tools. And these are the rules that I set up for tracks to be in my collection. I always check all the ID3 tags, because sometimes even a download platform like Beatport make spelling errors. I want to correct them. I also don't like all the capitals. And in this list, I don't know, it's about here. There you see artist, title, genre. These tags are a little bit of special because those tracks you can sort on in Rekordbox and also on the CDJ. So for me, those are valuable and I want to fill these in because, yeah, you can recall or you can find your tracks. Then there's some rules I made up for myself. An artist name in my collection does not have any prefix, like DJ Bobo or The Prodigy. In my collection, it's called Bobo and Prodigy. Why? Because if you have DJ Bobo and you're looking for that track, you're going through your collection, artist name, you go to the D, and then you're going to find the DJ Bobo, and then it's not there, and then it's like, oh yeah, he was called Bobo on this release. For me, it's simple. It's my collection. I determine the rules. And in my collection, there is no prefix for an artist name because it doesn't add any value for me. I know some artists really want to be called The Prodigy because that's the name of their band. In my collection, it's just called Prodigy. I have to find my tracks and, yeah, not somebody else. Then, in the beginning, I was just removing them with these 10 little fingers. I did all the typing, but then I found a tool, and the tool I'm going to show you in a bit is called TagScanner, and that does a lot of the heavy lifting for me. Also, and that's not really accurate anymore, but I also replace all special characters by their normal. So an E with two dots on top, in my collection it doesn't exist. It's just a normal E. It looks cleaner, it searches easier, and yeah, it's just a little bit cleaner to see. Then why would you fill in all those tags? Yeah, to make your life a little bit more easy. Because everything that you want to find in Rekordbox, you're searching, and the searching goes through the ID3 tags. So if you don't have any information in your ID3 tags, you're not going to find any files. Okay, and how are you going to put them in your collection? Well, if you're going to do that the Rekordbox way, if you have Rekordbox running, then and you are in your collection view, you choose any track. On the right side, there's this little eye icon. It will give you the file properties, and it has three tabs. The first tab, probably going to watch this the most, where is that file? But for now, it's important we go to the info tab, because what you see now is that this is all filled in the ID3 information. And if I'm going to change anything, so I'm going to make the artist name, I change it, as soon as I press enter, this file will be manipulated because this file will get its ID3 tags updated because Rekordbox is actually updating the ID3 information within that file. So as soon as I'm pressing enter, you will see it is updated here. And when I go to that file, I go to show in Finder to show that file on my hard drive. When I go to that file and I select get info, then I see an overview of all ID3 information that is stored for this track. And as you can see, make a little bit room here. The author or the artist's name is now changed with the thing that I just added. So you see Rekordbox is writing this information back to the file. So once you did it, you never have to do it again, if it's correctly done, of course. Otherwise, you have to go back. But this is one of the ways. And you can also add this information for multiple files. So if you select more than one, and if you would change like the genre or the album name, you go to the album name and you type new album. As soon as you press enter, it will update all these files. And this information is also written back to the ID3 tags of these files. This is not reversible. There is no Command-Z or Control-Z on the PC, so there's no undo, so watch carefully what you do. But that's generally the case when you're editing ID3 tags. Okay, so this is all nice and well, but for me, it can go faster and I need more options. So what I'm using is a program called Tag Scanner, and it's from xdlab.ru, so that's a Russian website. Normally, you should always be cautious for downloading stuff from the internet. I've been using this for a long time, but it's unfortunately PC only. But I'm having a Mac here. So I'm going to show you on my Mac how this tool works and how you could also use it when you are using a Macintosh computer. To start, you have to have a tool that's called VirtualBox. And VirtualBox is a virtual environment where you can install any operating system that you want. I've got one prepared, installed with Windows 10, and it's already started. So I just move over to my Windows environment. And again, this is on a Mac, and the Tag Scanner program, I've already installed it. I'm using it more often than just for this session. And I have a common list of files that needs some editing. And this is, there's some things in the bottom left corner. You see the amount of tracks, you see some specifications of the track that you've selected. And this program has certain options, and that's on the top of the screen. You have rename, edit, online, generate, and export. Export, obviously, we're not going to use because that's what Rekordbox is for. One of the first things that I want to show you is how you can edit this pretty fastly. There's one little catch, and if you're looking at the file names that I'm using, I always make sure that my file name is artist space hyphen space and then the title. So some information is always in my file name. What I always do when I have, let's imagine that this list is a list of files that I just download it from whatever, Beatport. You're gonna select everything, so I'm just gonna press Control A. What I'm then gonna do is gonna remove everything. So I go to Edit, and with Edit, I have the option to edit all the tags that are available. Some of them I'm gonna remove because every time when you download something, it might be filled in by somebody, or it is filled in with the name of somebody or useless information. I always remove everything. Lyricist, you can also remove it. When you press save, it's gonna say bye-bye to all the tags. And now you see that this whole list is completely empty of tags. So I have a clean start by now. What I wanna do is convert the file name to tag information, because in the tag in it's in here pretty well. So I select the file. Now I will go to generate. And generate is an automated function to generate a tag from the file name. It does a little bit more, but we're going to use this top function called generate tag from file name. So then you have to fill in a scheme. In other words, how is this file name built up? As I just told you, it's built up, and you can click in this little list, and there's a lot of stuff you can talk about. If you look at this, you can even do a lot of calculation with it. That's way further than I want to discuss today. The simple version is just click and type. So how was that file name build up? Oh yeah, artist. So then I'm going to select artist over here. I'm going to press space. Oh, this is one of the downsides, sorry. Hyphen space, and then it was the title. Below this box with the scheme of the file name, you will see an overview of what Tag Scanner is going to make out of it. So you will see the artist name is properly filled in and the title is also properly filled in. So when you press preview on this screen, you will see what is going to change. So everything that you see in purple, it's what is going to update. And if some information is already available, it's going to be black. So this is good. And I'm going to say generate. When I press generate again, you will see that it has filled in like the title and the name already. Okay, so that's pretty convenient. Can you do it a little bit faster? Of course. You can say Control A, because I know all my files are the same. I have generate still selected and I still have the same formula applied. So when I press preview, it's going to make like a pre-render and it's going to see what it's going to update. And when I go all the way up, you will see here this one entry is black. So that's something he does not need to update, and all the others are purple. It's going to update. So generate, and now it's filling in all these tags for me. So if I'm going to open the view, you will see properly it's got a lot of information already filled in. Not everything, but a lot of it. How are you going to go about this? Well, let me try to see if I can find those files, because it's built up in a similar way as I have the remaining bits of my record box. I have this test folder. And let's say I'm dividing it in two genres in my official collection. So I have two folders with a bunch of these files. That's how it looks on my hard drive at this point in time. You will see that the files are grouped per folder. So I have this first bit is for substyle one, and the other one is substyle two. First, the genre. I'm going to type Control A, so I'm going to select everything. Then I go to genre and I fill in the genre that it is. And this is just a bunch of test files, so I filled in the genre. Now, in my system, the folder is also the subgenre, which I put in the album tag. So I'm going to grab everything from the first one and I'm going to type in sub one. As soon as I press save, it's going to update all these files. Then I'm going to select the second group. I'm going to say sub 2. And if I select everything, I can fill in like the year. And I'm going to press save. This is the way how you can be very fast with Tag Scanner. Now, while I explain you how this program works, in the meanwhile, I've added the majority of the tags for like 145 tracks, as you can see in the bottom left of the screen. So is tagging taking a long time? Not if you're somewhat prepared. Is this all you can do with this program? No, because you will run into some issues when you're having a lot of CDs that you might have ripped. I'm going to change the view. I'm not going to do any grouping anymore, so just sort by file name, and I'll just go to the top. These files. This is something pretty common that you will see once you've ripped a CD single or anything like that, and you might want to address this, because I don't want the 0, 1, 2, 3 in my artist names, and I'm going to use Tag Scanner to remove it from me. So I'm going to select the group that has the similar format in the file name. I'm going to generate, and I already know that the last bit of this is correct. And you see an example a little bit below, but I want to get rid of the 0.4 point space. How you're going to do that is, I'm going to start again. So I want to ignore or delete the first part. So from this list, there is one option, and that's called ignore. So I'm going to ignore everything until a dot and a space. Then I continue with artist and title. So the example below shows you that it's going to ignore the 0.4 and then it's going to write the proper artist and genre file. And like this, you have removed a bunch of bad files. One of the other things that I really like about Tag Scanner, and this is going to be a little bit more advanced, and this is in the options, because every conversion step that you're going to do, you can have a set of rules applied to whatever you're converting. So when I go to the program options, I go to transformations. This is a list of all the things that I like being adjusted automatically. I have created two sets of rules. One, as you can see in the fields, this is only applied to the artist name, and the second one is applied to all the fields that are there. I have some certain rules. I just told you I'm trying to be efficient, and if you look at this bottom list, you will see that everything that places two DJs together with each other, like DJ A versus B and B featuring B, it's always how two artist names are tied up to each other. I like to have that the most efficient way, and the best way, in my opinion, to tie two artists together is just with the ampersand sign. So I'm going to remove everything that's like feed. This is what I came across when digitizing over time and adding the tracks. If people want, I can make a screenshot of it and post it somewhere so you can copy the rules. Unfortunately, I cannot make an export and offer these files for download simply because the program just doesn't have an export function for these set of rules. I hope the guys from Tag Scanner can one day get that back again. But there's one special case. As I told you before, I don't like that my artist names have a prefix. And in the beginning, these guys removed everything. But at some point in time, I found this awesome section. And what this basically is a regular expression. Yes, I want to explain you everything about regular expression, but that's something for your math teacher at school. What a regular expression is, it's like a formula type way how you describe whatever is in the tag. I told you before, I don't want to have any prefix within my collection. So I want to remove the Prodigy, the I want to remove, and I want to remove the DJ Bobo or DJ Jean or whatever, the DJ prefix. I do that with a regular expression. And how this regular expression works is that you build a formula like the dakje, whatever it's called in English, and then followed that. This character says beginning with, then follow the space. So everything that begins with the and then a space, that's what I want to replace by nothing. And this last bit is to keep everything coming back. So this set of rules convert or removes the prefixes automatically for me. If you look here, I have one track. I called him DJ Robbie Williams. Perhaps he's going to be DJ one day. Who knows? But if I convert generate tag from file name and I'm going to do a conversion, what you're going to see is that at the bottom it shows it's going to be DJ Robert Williams. But if I look at the preview, you will see that it has removed the DJ prefix automatically for me. So once you've set up the text transformation once, this is a set of rules that will be applied to everything that you do in this program. So it's going to take you a bunch of time. And it's also depending on a lot of things that are your preferences. Not everybody wants to have the same or stuff in his collection. I'm a little bit... I also don't want to have the round brackets. I all want everything in square brackets. And again, I did it manually at first, but then I found this section in TagScanner and I let TagScanner remove it automatically for me. How would you add something to this? It's very simple. You go to the preset that you have and you want to replace... every word mixer by player. So then you would do it like this. So you're going to change this. You're going to check this box, so only for whole words. And now you've added this rule. And I removed the old one because I should have pushed this plus sign. But this is the general idea how you're going to work with TagScanner. There's, for the Mr. Perfect, there's one more function that I want to show you with TagScanner. And that's something that I really like because a lot of my music was originated from vinyl. I have a memory about the cover of the vinyl, so I would like to preserve that in my collection. So if I'm gonna get a track, and you might know of the website called Discogs. Oh, by the way, this is the website of TagScanner, xdlab.ru, and I'll post a link somewhere, whatever. This is a Russian website, and I just learned a little bit of Russian. Or you can just hit this button, English, and then you get an English interface. When you go download, you download the top version, the Exe, that's an installer. I like it because I use it a lot, but please watch carefully when you are going to look for this program. It's a free tool, so you can download it for free, but check the website, don't make mistakes, and download the proper bit of software. The TagScanner has a link to something, some website called Discogs. And Discogs is like an online library of information of released tracks, and you can find like everything here. So if you have something like called Jean Delange, you will see that when you hit it, you will see all the releases that has this track on it. And there's also already a lot of information stored within this website. I would like to have that in my record box. How? Well, you use the online function of TagScanner. And the online function, as you can see on the right, gives you the opportunity to give a source where you want to get this information from. I've selected Discogs because that's what I use and that's where I find the most music that I play. By the way, you need to have an account on Discogs because Discogs does not allow a program to get all the information for their website. It's going to do it as you logged in. So you have to link your account to TagScanner once and then everything works like I show you in here. I select the one with artist space hyphen space and then the title. I just know it works best, and then you press this little search icon. Now it's going to get online and withdraw all this information from Discogs. As soon as you have what you have, you can press escape and then it's going to stop. So now I'm looking for this release. You see a lot of information already. You can press this little triangle and this opens the release. So now you see the content of this CD or CD single, whatever. So we've got Focus. This was the original version. The checkbox is set, so you can do a preview. I already know what's going to happen, so I'm just going to press save. And when I now go to edit, you will see that it has filled in for me the year, but it has overwritten the genre and the album name that I just filled in. So you might need to do these two again, that you're going to make this a sub one again, and the genre was used dance before. But the nice thing is, if you look a little bit lower, you will see that it also got an image from that website and added it to this file. So this is a way how you can get a lot of your album art working. Yes, it's a little bit of work. And normally I would take this picture, get it in Photoshop, make it properly square, no white lines, and then up the saturation a bit and then use that image. But that's not for today. Once you get used to it, you get pretty speedy with it. Back to the presentation. Because so these rules are all applied, and I do this with Tag Scanner. And I should have showed you this before I went to Tag Scanner, but now you've seen my slide as well. Okay, that's the majority of stuff that I wanted to tell you. That's all in the pre-process before I get things going into Rekordbox. Now, when I go into Rekordbox, I can close the rest. I'm gonna close this again. So now we are here in Rekordbox. And what can you see in Rekordbox? For those that do not know, this whole top section is a player. This is where you play a track and where you can see what's currently running in your collection. Below that, you have your collection view. Most of the time, you want to make sure that you select either your collection to view all the files, or you can select a playlist and then you see only the contents of that playlist. Just above your collection, you have a row over here. This is called the playlist palette. You can hide it and you can show it again. And I'll get back to that in a little bit later. So these are the general things that you have. I want to walk you through the preferences in Rekordbox, because a lot of these you know, or you made a choice, or you put them in. I want to explain you what it's all about. The first page are the settings for your view properties. In the top section, you can change the letter, the font size, and the spacing, so you can make it a little bit easier to read. The next section in the layout determines everything that you see on the left-hand side in the tree browser. So if I close everything here, I'm going to open the preferences again. When I'm going to uncheck the box for iTunes, it's going to add or remove iTunes from that view. Some of you know me already. You know how much I love iTunes, so uncheck it. That's the best thing that you can do. The other things that you see here are the settings for in Rekordbox. I'm going to show you these a little bit later on, but these are the settings for Rekordbox. And what you can do, you can choose the color of the waveform. This is like the RGB version. You can also make it blue. In order for it to update, you have to close the preferences, and now you see what the blue is about. The waveforms that you see over here are called half waveforms. So when you change the view and you set them to full waveform, again, I have to close it. But now what you will see is that it's now measured from the center, like your left goes up and your right goes down. While when it's half, it's all from the bottom and you're actually only seeing one side of it. I prefer seeing half a preview, because then I have the highest resolution to see the peaks and the valleys in my waveforms. And all these settings are only for in Rekordbox itself. At the end, you will see your key display. The key display format is how should you display the key. In Pioneer, traditionally, it would be D minor or F-ish. But in other programs, people might get used to an alphanumerical way how you're going to see it. If you're going to see this column with the blue square, with the green squares, it's the keys. And when I change it to alphanumeric, it's going to update it, and this is how alphanumeric keys are showing. They actually mean the same thing. So there's no difference in key, it's only written different. And you might recognize this from Mixed in Key, because that's a way Mixed in Key traditionally writes it. I'm going to put it on Classic, because that's the true key, and for me it's easier to remember. The audio tab doesn't have a lot of stuff going on. If you're going to use a controller, you're going to choose your controller from this pull-down or any connected sound card that you're going to use. If you're going to have a Pioneer product that you want to output your sound to, with the latest releases of Rekordbox, you always get all the latest driver versions as well. So this button over here with the driver, and it opens up a window, and in this window you will see most of the time the latest versions of the drivers. So if you have a computer with you with Rekordbox on it, you always bring the latest drivers for all the products that that we support with you. So you don't have to find any internet connection, and you can just install the driver that you need. Analyze tab. This is what's going to happen after you import files to Rekordbox. Then the tracks will be analyzed, and you can make a lot of settings. You get a pop-up every time you're gonna import files, so they need to be analyzed. Then you're gonna see these options in the top screen. The beginning is normal or dynamic. Normal analyzes has a steady BPM throughout the track, so every distance between every beat is the same. If you have more acoustical tracks, or you have live tracks, or bad vinyl recordings, or tracks from really old tracks when there were no drum machines. Remember, if there's a drummer at the end of the track, he's probably not as tight as in the beginning of the track. So sometimes by older music you have to choose dynamic. My advice would be put this on normal and only do a single track in dynamic analyze only when it is needed, because you lose some of the adjustments in the beat grid when you choose for dynamic. The BPM range, it's probably set by default because not a lot of people are changing it, and I was just checking, and the top choice 70 to 180, that's the traditional Pioneer BPM range. In my case, I found out that majority of my tracks are over 100 BPM, and they can exceed 200 BPM as well. So 108, 215 is for me the best choice to choose, but you can choose whatever fits your collection best. And every time you're gonna import files, you get this pop-up and you can adjust it again. The next box is for what is going to be analyzed once you got files in, and the auto analysis enabled. This is something I really like, and it's recently added. It used to be that once you imported 1,000 tracks, you're gonna analyze them, or you're gonna start Rekordbox, it's always going to analyze those tracks. But for some reason, you might not want that, and there was no way to toggle it on and off. But now you can disable the auto analyze, and it should stop analyzing when you make this choice, because as soon as you close the pull down, it's stored on your computer. Sometimes you have to restart Rekordbox, and then it's not going to do the analyzing. There will be still be a notification that there's like 200 tracks that needs to be analyzed, but it's not going to do it. At the end, analysis process in performance or normal. It's by default set to normal. What it then does is when you're going to import your tracks, it's going to use roughly about 50% of your CPU power to do the analyzing. So in the background, you can watch YouTube, play a game. You have some computer room left. I always put this on performance, and then I realize myself that once I'm going to import tracks in my collection, I have to wait. And performance is using 100% of your CPU power for analyzing. So it goes almost twice as fast as normal, but it draws a lot of energy. So don't do that when you do not have a power cable connected. And your computer will get hot, especially this area in the middle. That's going to be really hot. So if you have a lot of files, I always put something below my computer so it has a little bit of airflow under it, so it's not getting super warm. CDJ and device is something I'm gonna end with. Keyboard, this is for keyboard shortcuts. I don't think I need to explain a lot about it because that's the same in a lot of software. And in advanced, you will see the remaining bits of things that you can change. These are pretty specific. Like you have some advanced stuff to do with your database. I would not change this. There's always things that you can do. The second tab, browse. These balls Yeah, okay, excuse me the word, but these little colored dots is just like a notepad. So this is where you can write something as a reminder what these colors mean in your collection, because there's two or three things that you can do with colors in your collection. Recordings, nothing special to say about, and in others you will see some of the newer things like the beat quantize. The beat quantize value used to be only on and off, and it was always set to a full beat, but now you can change it to 1/16th, 1/8th, 1/4th of a beat, so you can also have it on the hi-hats just in between the beats. CDJ and devices. These settings you are now recognizing because they were also in the view part, but these are the settings that you're going to write on your USB device and you can load them on a CDJ. So when you set this up and you load your settings on a CDJ, you get all these settings imported just like that. So you can change the color of the waveform, and again this is only applying to the CDJ. You can choose half or full waveform, and this only applies to the small waveform from the total track that you will be seeing on the CDJ. It does not change the main big waveform that you see, and also for the key format. Then category. If you want to browse on a certain track that you have in your collection, you have to make that category like an active category. So you could have the original artist, everything on the right side of the screen. This is what you'll be able to browse, and you can drag stuff left and right. And if you use artist a lot, you can move artist to the upside. What I would add here, if you have not done it, is key and BPM. And in a future stream, I will probably show you what's the use of it. But for now, I would add these just to be sure. Then you have the sort tab. And the sort tab just looks almost the same. But what this is if you're looking at a certain list, and it could be like a genre or it could be like a playlist, you can resort that list by, and that's where you have the things that you've activated for the sort options. And it works the same, you can move stuff up and down, you can put stuff from left to right or get it back again. So this is how you're going to set up what you use and put on top the things that you use most. So that saves you the most work when navigating on a CDJ. The column on some certain overviews, you have the whole screen filled with the title of the track. I don't like that. I would rather see half of the title and half of the artist, as long as it fits the screen. So by default, this is not specified, and I've changed this to the artist name. So wherever the CDJ can, it's going to put the artist name next to the title of the track. If people are using hotkeys, you can set up the hotkeys to be auto-loading once you load a track. That is a little bit specific, so perhaps I'm gonna dive into that a little bit later. And within device, normally you should not have to change it because these are some of our older products. The best thing you can do, set it on CDJ, XDJ. And please take care for this one, because it, in some installations, it's still activated, but rethink about it if you want it. Delete tracks. So what does it say? Delete playlist tracks from device if playlist is deleted. Okay, so what does this mean? If I'm going to remove a playlist from my USB, it's also going to remove all the files or the tracks that are in that playlist. That's a good way to make room on your USB. But the downside is that if a track is also in another playlist, if this playlist is deleted, it removes all the tracks, so that track will also be removed from any other playlist it is in on your USB. So most of the time you want to have this unchecked. Then we have the My Settings. The My Settings is a list of functions and settings that you can make in Rekordbox, and these are stored on a USB device once you export a few tracks to it, or as soon as you insert a USB device and Rekordbox recognizes them. They are stored on the USB device. They are not automatically loaded. And I will show you in a second how they will get loaded. What are these settings? These settings is, when you go through the list, the first section is play or autoplay. This is an action that is triggered at the end of a track. So if a track has played, then this setting applies. So at the end, it will look at it and see, okay, if it's single, then it's going to stop at the end of the track. If you put this on continue, it will check if it's playing in a playlist. And if it's playing in a playlist, it will automatically load the next track. I put it on single because I want to have this setting that the track, once it's played, is always stopping. If I'm going to look on the CDJ, how are you going to get to the CDJ? You see the menu button, and above it says utility. So if you hold this button for a second, you are going to enter the utility mode. And you will have a list here with a lot of the features that I'm going to discuss about. So you see the play mode, there's a little triangle. When you press the rotary, the triangle moves over. And now when you rotate the rotary, it will change this value. And pressing it again, and then you can browse again. So this is how you get here. One little bonus tip is here on the left, you will have this button, and there's a little bit of a secret code on top of it. You will see a dot and then timeout, a bar, and then auto cue. What this means is if you press this button once, you toggle the timeout. If you hold this button for a second, you're going to toggle the auto cue mode. So you will see in the center remaining or elapsed, and when you hold it, you will see that auto cue is toggling. And this is the secret code you will see, and now you will see it on more places that is actually written all over our equipment. So this is on the CDJ. The next setting that you can make is eject, lock and load. If you have this on lock, you cannot load a track once a deck is playing. So you have to stop playback either by holding the platter or pressing the pause key, but you can set it to lock or unlock. It's something like when you play with vinyl. Everybody that plays with vinyl has come to this at least once in their career. You did your mix, you made the mix, and then you took the wrong needle off the track, and then it gets silent in the club. First time you're like, whoa, what am I gonna do? The next time you've learned. So once the next time you did it, you were like, oh, shizzles, 2, 3, 4. And then just drop it on. Dance floor probably is not even going to notice. But that's how you can sort it on vinyl. In digital, you can make this selection, something like that. I don't have this activated because what I came across is that if I made a mix, I'm already browsing. I want to load a new track. And then it starts blinking like I cannot load and have to hold it. So for me, I turn this off. Needle lock. Needle lock is on the CDJ. Normally, once you have a track loaded, at the bottom, you will see a miniature waveform of the whole track. And if you have the deck, if you touch it, the playback position is going to move to wherever that you dropped your finger on. I have that on lock because sometimes when you have long sleeves, it touches the display, or somebody from the dance floor is reaching out over the decks and they're touching whatever. They should not do it, but I have that on lock because I don't want to press it accidentally. Then we have the quantize beat value. Quantize snaps a certain action to the beat, and just going to explain you a little bit more in one of the next streams when we're going to dive much deeper into the Nexus 2. But you can set it on half a beat, so in between two beat grid markers, or even at a more narrow step, like 1/8 of a beat. Then you have auto hot cue loading. If you set hot cues for a track and you load that track, this setting applies. So if you have hot cue loading activated with this checkbox over here, the hot cues will automatically be loaded. But sometimes you want to keep the hot cues from the previous track for whatever reason. So this might be a setting that's very dependent on how you use hot cues and what you do with it. So there's no right or wrong again. Any of these settings, there's no right and wrong. It's your settings, it's your CDJ. You have to play, you decide whatever you like. Then we have auto cue level. Auto cue level is working in conjunction with the auto queue setting. An auto queue is what happens after a track has been loaded. If auto queue is activated, the track will stand still at the first little bit of audio that it detects and then wait for further commands what it has to do. I turn this on because even though I have it on single mode, it should not load the next track, but for whatever reason, if a track is loaded, it's not going to be playing unless I press the play button. So I got auto queue activated. To above, this is the options that you can set the audio level to be. I set it to minus 36. How a decibel scale works, 0 dB is the loudest, minus 32 and minus 78. So if you put it at minus 36, sorry, not 32, if you put it at minus 36, it's the highest chance to be a kick. And that's what I want. If you have a track that starts with a riser, like if you put it on like minus 70 or minus 68 or whatever, it might trigger within that riser and not at the beat that follows the riser. So you might want to change this to whatever works for you best. For me, it works best on minus 36. Then you have the timeout. The timeout is the display of time, how much seconds or minutes the track has been running or how long you still have at the end. And I just showed you on the CDJ that little button thing. Then you have the jog mode. Jog mode is when it's in vinyl, the top of the platter is touch sensitive and you can scratch, while the outer rim is for the pitch bend. If you put this on CDJ mode, then the whole touch sensitive thing of the jog is gone and everything is going to do the pitch bend. I turn it on vinyl. I'm a vinyl jog and I'm used to that feeling. That's what I prefer. Tempo range, obviously just check whatever fits your performance best. I think minus 10 is a proper setting, because if you need more than 10%, perhaps you should select a different track. Master tempo. Master tempo is a pioneer feature that's been on our CDJs ever since the CDJ 500 launched in 97. And what it does is it keeps the pitch of the track as if it was played at 0%, even though you increase or decrease the pitch. So it's making it sound like the original, even though the speed is lower or higher. Pioneer is still improving on the master tempo to work. So the quality is improved over time again and again. So, and I think at this point in time, within 10% plus or minus, it's hardly hearable in the majority of music styles. If you go into the extremes, yes, you're gonna hear the master tempo processing, but that's not how we intended it to be. So master tempo, I have it off. I just DJ the track. I'm not always using key harmonic mixing. So I have to turn it off. Quantize snaps certain features like loop and cue and hot cue pressing, and also the reverse, that it only is triggered whenever a beat grid marker passes. So it's synchronized to the beats of the track if you have set your beat grid properly. Of course, you have sync, which is automatically synchronizing the speed of two decks. And sync is not synchronizing audio. Sync is synchronizing the beat grids. So if you're going to use either quantize feature or the sync feature, make sure that your beat grid is set properly. And I will show you in the next stream how that's going to work. Then you have phase meter. Phase meter could be type 1 or type 2. Type 1 is how we always have it. And type 2 is new on a CDJ. If I look on a CDJ, here on the top, you will see the phase meter. And the phase meter now is set to 2, and this is 1. This is what you probably recognize, like the 4 boxes. And this is how the beat grid scrolls over your screen. Then you have some options for the illumination of the deck. So you have the LCD brightness. You can set it anywhere between 1 and 5. If you play outside in the summer, put it on 5. If you play in a club, put it on 3 or even lower like that. If you're in a club and you have like 4 CDJs on your deck, and it's all illuminated by 5, there's a lot of white light coming from below. That might not give you the best pictures on social. How does it look in the when I go on the CDJ? I hold the utility button and somewhere down you will see LCD brightness, and it's set to 3, this is 1, and this is 5. So make any setting that you want. The remaining bit of this list is all illumination related. So you have slip flashing. If you activate slip, the whole deck is going to blink a few times. You can deactivate it. On-air display, when you have a mixer also part of the Pro DJ Link in the booth, when you open the fader, there's a red illumination on the jog wheel. And I cannot show you right now. It was not in build. I cannot show you right now. But it's the jog wheel that's illuminated red. Then you have the jog ring brightness. It speaks for itself. Jog ring indicator is a little circle in the center display on the CDJ. You have your disc slot illumination, which is the strip on the front of the CDJ. And you've got your pad and button illumination that you can make changes of. These are the settings that you can make. And once you have a USB in your computer and you're going to export a playlist or a track or update anything on the USB, your settings will be saved there as well. How are they loaded on a CDJ? Of course, always properly eject your device, never just yank them out. Also, when you're having a CDJ, always press the eject button. Once I have my CDJ and I insert the USB and I press the USB select button, you will see this blue bar and it says my settings data is found. Do you want me to load it? It is not loaded at this point in time. If you want to load it in the browse screen or one step back like the device screen, when you press the menu button, you have some options and one of the options is load settings. If this is not illuminated or selectable, the deck might be running. So you have to stop the deck and then press. Now the settings were loaded to the player. And with this short handling, you will see that it's very easy to load like a 15 or 20 settings to your CDJ. Unfortunately, the time for today is already there. So I'm going to check in the comment section what you guys have been putting there, and I will get back to you and try to answer all the questions that you put there. Be back in a second.